Test. It's good to see you all here tonight. Welcome online, folks. As we were praying about all of you being here, we actually were already praying about healing, already praying about being set free, already praying about loneliness being broken, hope being restored. And the word that came to me was, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We have been offered a new chance, a new freedom to live a new way in Him. By His stripes, we've been healed. By His love, we've been set free. And we will never be the same. We have this. We have this promise. Lord, we ask that you be with us in this evening, that you guide our hearts, that you touch each one here, that you bless us in a way that we've never known before, that you come and make a way in our hearts that we come closer to you. We praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's sing about that, this great God of ours who is a way maker.
That is who you are. it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Lord, we thank you that this is who you are, that you make a way where we thought there would be no way. You came and made a way for us to come and be a part of your life for all eternity. You came, left your throne of glory to come and be a sacrifice for us, that our lives might be transformed. And we are eternally grateful for that. In your very first sermon, you said that the Spirit of the Lord was upon you because he had anointed you to proclaim good news to the poor. He had sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, and to provide for those who grieve, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair, that we might be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for his splendor. You said you would rebuild devastation of generations, bring us back to life, mend our sorrows, mend our brokenness, heal our bodies, heal our relationships, heal our relationship with you. You knew it was coming. You knew the cost, and yet you came. You didn't count glory of heaven something to be grasped, but humbled yourself, even becoming like us, fully human, and yet you still fully divine. Cross awaited, but for the joy before you, and you endured it. You considered it a joy to have us in relationship with you. And you started to explain that to your disciples that night of Passover, when you took the bread and you took the cup, when you shared the bread with the disciples, you said, "This is my body, which is given for you." Your body given for us, Lord. You picked up the cup, gave your Father thanks, incredibly so, that the cup of your blood, you would say, "Thank you, Father, that I could give this, your sacrifice." You said, "Thanks." You gave your Father thanks. And then you offered this to those you loved. "This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you eat of this and drink from this, do it in remembrance of you." So in remembrance, Lord, of these, your mighty acts, we do, heart, mind, body, and soul, give ourselves to you. And we thank you for your salvation bought for us by your blood and your body. If those who are helping would come, the way we do communion here, everybody, this table, it doesn't belong to this congregation, this table belongs to the Lord, and he invites all who would come and receive him to come. So when you are ready, come. I'm going to serve our communion, and then I invite you to come forward.
See you.
Lord, you gave yourself for us. We are so forever grateful. We offer ourselves to you, Lord, that we might be yours all the days of our life, that we might walk with you and be led by you as your kingdom priests here, called to share your love with others. We thank you, Lord, that you make that possible. And as those that you love and hold dear, we join together with that prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Again, thank you for being here. Some of you are new. We do take an offering. There's no obligation. It's sowing into this ministry that we are able to continue to provide these services. So if the Spirit moves you, feel free to put something in the plate. Once my ushers stand up and figure out who they are and come forward and get the plate. The restrooms are out the side and down the hall. Someone in the back can show you how to get there. We're going to sing for a while right now, so I'm going to invite you to stand up. There's another plate here, Daria, right here. So, Lord, as you lead us to share, we share these offerings to you, but they are just tokens of what we really want to give you, which is our hearts. So, Lord, receive us through our prayers, through our need, through our worship, through our lives, and through these gifts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Good evening, everyone. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this evening. Amen. I know for some of us it's our second service or our third service, but no matter what service it is, we are always grateful to be able to praise the name of Jesus. Amen. So I'm going to invite everyone to go ahead and stand on your feet if you are able and if you are ready to worship. Amen. Tell the person next to you, are you ready to worship the Lord this evening? Amen. Hallelujah. Machine. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen. Come on, let's declare one more time. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. I'm pressed but not cursed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for his promise. this will endure. This joy will be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, this joy comes in the morning. Yes, I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Joy of the Lord. Oh, we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Oh, one last time. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Hallelujah. Amen. That was a good warm-up. Amen? Good warm-up? All right. Hallelujah. I want to hear everyone in this house sing the song. Amen.
And these are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, a famine and darkness and sorrow, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Behold, He comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year to believe. And out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
Yes, and these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And we are the lepers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, He comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Have the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year to believe. And out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Declare that there's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call. Lift your voice, this thing that you believe, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call. Lift your voice, this thing that you believe, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Father, we praise you, Lord. You call me out upon the waters, a great unknown where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mysteries, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. Until you call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves, when oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours. You are mine. Oh, oh, oh. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you'll never fail and you won't start now. And I will call upon your my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Oh, oh, borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, me with my trust without borders, let me walk upon the waters wherever you will call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves,
When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't pump the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give me answers as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. You know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things, be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't pump the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. Strength and comfort, you are my steady head, you are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your plans are always higher, your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go, you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't pop the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust in you.
wanna welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in all his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Oh, the sun sets free. Oh, he's free in me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Oh, the sun sets free. Oh, it's free in me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say. Yes, I am who you say I am. Oh, the sun sets free. Oh, it's free in me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
I want to know you more.
Thank you for ministering to us in this place right now. We thank you for your presence, Lord. We thank you that you call us ever deeper into a loving relationship with you. Praise your name, Lord. Even now, Lord, we ask that you continue to stir our hearts, stir our minds, open us more to your work of healing, Lord, your work of transformation, your work of salvation, your work of reconciliation. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that you brought us together for this night. We praise you. Thank you, Lord. Well, friends, it's an honor and a privilege to introduce Dr. David Levy. Trish and I read his book, Gray Matter, out loud, traveling between Texas and California. Once we started, we couldn't put it down. It's hard to fathom. Talk about humility. The pages are just so alive. It's like I was in the hospital hallway watching this transpire. He's getting up the nerve to say, I'm going to pray with this patient. And he steps in, and then all of a sudden there's a nurse that comes in, and he steps back up. And he's reading the chart, and he's reading the fine print on the chart. And he's reading and reading. We're just busting up laughing. Here's this world-class neurosurgeon who has the audacity to say, give me the hardest patients. I can't wait. But when you started working on him, Lord, it's like, ooh, this is different. I don't know if I can do this. So it starts with that humility. But there's a chapter in here called Snatched from Hell, I think it is. And reading that, it just makes you cry. Because the journey that he's been on is a journey, as it says, of discovering the power of prayer, one patient at a time. By the end of the book, you see that when he has people in front of him, he's an instrument of the Holy Spirit, whether it's in the operating room or in his office. And those prayers change lives. He offers people to reconsider what they're holding on to. Even going out on a limb saying, well, sometimes there's an issue in the past that might be affecting this disease, this structure in your brain, this pain. Have people walk out on them, have people not be happy with them, and then things change. And they say, what did you do? What happened? It's the Lord. It's the Lord. It's the Lord. So we are blessed. I'm blessed to have had a chance to meet you. And just be welcomed into your spirit and your sphere. And his wife is here as well. Give her a warm welcome.
Thank you, God. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Lord, I ask that you pour out your spirit even more on this place through this willing servant as he offers his testimony, his words of wisdom, straight from the throne of heaven for us tonight. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. It's good to be here. Of all the many causes of illness, I believe there is one primary cause that I want to talk about this evening. More than the lack of nutrition, lack of sleep, lack of exercise, more than bacteria, viruses, pollution, smoking, all of those things will harm your health. But there is nothing that will harm your health more than unhealthy relationships. The stress caused by unhealthy relationships. And that's what I want to talk about tonight. And under the broad heading of unhealthy relationships or difficult relationships, let's break that down into the relationship with others, people who have hurt you, it's difficult to forgive, difficult situations, things that you remember from the past that, ooh, when you think about that, you it's like a traumatic event. Second category, relationship with yourself. Things that you've done that you regret. You can't believe you did that. Oh, and the condemnation you feel. The accuser, the accusations, the doubt, the regret. Third category is your relationship with God. Maybe there was a time in your life when you just felt much closer to God than you feel right now. And if you look back and if you search your memory and you ask the Holy Spirit, what happened between when things were so good and now? He may reveal to you maybe something that you prayed for, something you really wanted, something that was really a good thing, but you didn't get that prayer answered, and a little bit of doubt came in. And somehow, well, you can't get angry with God, but you just noticed some distance. Well, some people get angry with God. It's okay. He has very broad shoulders. But that disappointment we need to work through. See, relationships are tricky. I don't know about you, but from the time I was about 16 years old, I thought I was pretty good at relationships. I'd watched enough sitcoms where no matter how big the problem, in 30 minutes or less, it was over. Everyone was laughing. This was just... relationships are no problem. Easy to get into, easy to be successful at, a lot of fun. So I'm going to tell you a story tonight, a little bit of a vulnerable story. But I want us to take a look at our relationships. You know, nobody is good at relationships. You have to learn. I finished my many years of school, many, many years of training, got out into practice, and I started hearing this refrain from my parents, from my colleagues, from my friends. David, it's time for you to settle down. Well, a neurosurgeon knows what that means. It could mean two things. Number one, it's time to get married, or number two, it's time to buy a very expensive sports car. But about the time I was hearing all those, it's time to settle down, I was also learning to surf here in San Diego, and I had a surfing buddy, and he said, dude, you know, that's the way they talk, you know, I think it helps them. They don't have to remember any names that way. Everyone's just dude. Dude, you need to meet my cousin Susie. Oh, I'd love to meet your cousin Susie. Oh, where is she? Oh, she lives in Seattle. I said, Seattle? I don't want to go to Seattle. I said, dude, her dad's famous. Oh, Seattle. Well, you know, I could go. So I arranged a medical consulting agreement with a company in Seattle, and I flew up. And at the end, I had a blind date with Susie. And she was cute. She was from a great family. Her father was a well-known Christian author. She talked fondly. She was the youngest of a large family with loved her nieces and nephews. She talked fondly of everybody in the family. I thought, wow, I would love to be a part of this family. I flew back to San Diego, made another arrangement to go up and see Susie, and we went on a hike. And at the end of that visit, I thought, wow, I think this is going well. I said, Susie, look, we're both over 30. I don't want to play games. You know, I want to pursue this relationship with you. Oh, Susie was so happy. And I was happy, and we began talking on the phone pretty much every night. She had a very calm voice, kind of a whispery voice, which really calmed my nerves. And I thought, wow, this is just great. We soon became my best friend. I went up to Seattle a third time. I'm staying with her parents, and this time I'd had a difficult work week, and things were a little off. I didn't have such a good time. And so at the end of the visit, I said to Susie, you know, this long-distance relationship is a little bit tough. I think we should slow things down. Oh, she started to cry. She took a pillow off the couch and clutched it, and she said, you're just like every other guy. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. I'm a neurosurgeon. I'm not like every other guy. I spent a long time in school not to be like every other guy. So I can work harder at this. I can do this. It's just I just don't have all the skills, all the relationship skills. But let's keep trying at this. So I flew back. Now I'm only going up about once a month or so because of my call schedule and the busyness at work. But I went up the fourth time, staying with the parents, and again, it was sort of, we went on a hike, and I'm starting to kind of be a little bit bored with Susie. For some reason, it's just not really there for me. I can't explain it, and so I say to her, look, something's not quite right in this relationship. Oh, she started to cry again. You don't know anything about relationships. Well, true, all right, I'll give you that, but I'll try harder. I think I can make this work. And so go back. I'm on the phone again, enjoying our phone conversations. Went up a fifth time. And this time I'm staying with the parents. And interestingly enough, this father, this famous father, who I really wanted to see Susie because of him, he'd never actually spoken to me. And I'm staying in the house, and we're passing each other in the hallway, and I sort of stopped, and he could say, oh, David, how are you doing? I guess he was, sort of always busy in his office writing new books or talking with other famous people, whatever famous people do. Dave, how are you doing? I said, things are going okay, but I'm every time I try to talk with Susie about the relationship, she starts to cry. He said, oh, He said, I'll speak to her about that. So I'm just sort of standing there thinking, look, I want some help. I'm looking for some help. I want a father. I want someone to help me with this. And he could tell that I needed something else, and so he said, he put his hands together, he said, David, a woman is like a fragile egg. You have to be very careful with them. I said, oh, that's it. That's what I'm missing. I'm missing that kind of wisdom. That's what I'm looking for. A woman is that I walked away sort of, oh, I can't, don't drop the egg. I've got this fragile egg, and I've got to, this is my responsibility. So I flew back home with kind of redoubled my efforts that this is going to, I have got to make this thing work. This is what real Christian men do, is we make relationships work. Well, while I was home on this visit, I decided to get some counsel from this married guy I know. You know, when you're single, you believe that married people are relational geniuses. That they know all this stuff that's secret. You've got to be in a club, and the only way to get in a club is to get married. If you're not married, you don't have the information that the married people have. It's secret handshakes, all kinds of codes. So I asked my buddy, Matt. I said, hey, I need to come over and see you. So Matt's a lawyer, and I went over, and he said, hey, what's the problem? I said, well, I've got this situation. I've got a woman that everyone thinks is wonderful, is just right for me. Everything looks good on paper, Matt, but I don't have any feelings for her. He said, oh, you young people, feelings, schmeelings. Who needs feelings? They all go away in 6 months anyway. Another brilliant piece of advice from a married man. 6 months? That's it? He goes, sometime sooner. I said, Matt, I at least like my 6 months. I don't have anything now. Can I get 6 months? You know what your problem is? You've never made a commitment. Commit, and the feelings will come. Oh. Another piece of brilliant relational advice. The only thing I hadn't tried. I was trying to pull away, and that wasn't helping. He's saying, oh, you don't like someone, so move toward them. Well, it, I guess, works in some arranged marriages, so I thought, this almost sounds scientific, like this behavioral modification thing. That's the only thing I haven't tried. Made an appointment. Flew to Seattle, and with Susie's family presence, I asked her to marry me. I just heard a lot of women groan. I heard a lot of the men saying, sounds reasonable. Yeah, scientific. I think it's worth a shot. Well, Susie was so happy. She was so happy. Her parents were happy, her father was happy and shook my hand and welcomed me to the family, just what I wanted. Her mother even said, oh, I've had a dream that Susie would be married this year, and you are the fulfillment of that dream. Wow, how about that for a pedestal, knight in shining armor? Just what I wanted to feel. And you know, I actually had some feelings that day. There's nothing like being around a woman who's that happy. And a happy family to make you actually happy and feeling like you've got some feelings. And you start planning weddings. It's so fun to be such a hero to this famous family that you will soon be a part of. Flew back to San Diego. We kept talking on the phone. Susie sold her car. She quit her job. And she made plans to move to San Diego. And I was there in the airport to receive her. Now, another reason I wanted to be engaged, I would not have wanted my sister to move to another city for a guy unless there was a commitment. So I was thinking, okay, I'll make a commitment. We need to be in the same city to work this out. I'm there in the airport waiting for the feelings to come over me at any time. As she comes down the jetway to me, I'm thinking, soon there's going to be fireworks at some point. I just know it. And she got right up to me. Vanilla. I didn't feel anything. And so I gave her this sort of brotherly hug and welcomed her to San Diego. And we found her an apartment and got her moved in. You know, I'm busy at work, still doing my surgical busyness, lots and lots of distractions, but I felt the relationship was pretty stable. I had a date every weekend now. It was nice, and we, you know, would eat together a couple times during the week. I guess this is as good as it gets. I'm taking care of my fragile egg. About 2 months into this, I started having some health concerns. I started having some reflux, some GI reflux. Well, fortunately, I'm a doctor and we can handle that. I didn't even need to go to the pharmacy, just go to the get some over-the-counter meds. But after a couple weeks, the Maalox and the Tums weren't working so well anymore. And I had to stop one of the GI guys in the hospital and say, hey, I'm having some issues. I got heartburn and, oh, so he wrote me a prescription medication. I got this. Started taking those pills and they worked a bit, but a little bit later, a few weeks later, I was hurting again. And then I noticed after a few more months, I had lost about 10 pounds. Indigestion, burping all the time, pain in the stomach area. And then one morning I woke up with a mass, size of my fist, and I knew I'd been to medical school, weight loss, a mass, pain in the stomach, probably have a tumor. Called the GI guys and he said, well, we need to scope you. Susie drove me to the appointment. They put me under sedation, put the scope down, took a look, woke me back up. He said, we didn't see a tumor. We didn't find any tumor. But what we found was irritation of the stomach lining. We found gastritis. Have you been under any stress lately? Well, Susie's right there. She's holding onto my arm, and I look at her. I said, I've got a woman who loves me, and I mean, my job is stressful, but no, I can't think of anything. So Susie drove me home, dropped me off at my place. I went inside and the sedation is wearing off and I'm trying to think, look, I've had, my job is stressful, but what is different this last 6 months than the previous 6 months? Eureka. It's her. You know how you feel when you just found a solution to your problem? And like, it's amazing. And then the next moment, like, I'm going to have to tell her. And then I realized subconsciously I probably was hoping I had a tumor because I'd be dead in a couple of months and I wouldn't have to have this conversation with Susie because she was going to be very, very angry. But I knew the truth now, and so you would think that I would have gone right ahead and told her, but you'd be wrong. Just like most of you, I said, no, I can live with this. I think I can make this work. Are there any other pills I can take? Is there a surgery? is there some way that I don't have to deal with this person? I don't have to make this person I care about, this person I'm supposed to be caring for, I don't make them angry with me. And so I waited a couple more months, and I lost a couple more pounds, maybe 20 pounds now. Now I mean, the biggest sacrifice here was I'm unable to eat Mexican food from San Diego, right? It's a crime. It's a serious thing to live in San Diego and not eating Mexican food. But then now I'm down, then there was no salad dressing, no garlic, no onions, no pepper. But by the time I had the scope, you know, I was down to very little. And a few months later, now I'm eating just rice cakes and some soy milk. I mean, that is no salt. I lost 20 pounds, and I realize either I'm going to have to tell her and break up with her, or I will slowly starve to death. I will perish by starvation. And so I made a date with Susie to meet her at breakfast one Saturday morning. I ordered oatmeal, that was on my diet, and let her finish her breakfast, and then I said, Susie, this is not working. You want to quit? Are you a quitter? See, earlier she would have had me. I would have said, no, I'm not a quitter. I can't do this anymore. You know, in the Bible, when people were engaged, they were obligated to get married. I didn't say anything. I realized I probably, at this point, was not going to make it in the Bible. But I needed to end this relationship, even if I didn't make it in the Bible. And there was what I was afraid of. If you've seen the mushroom cloud for the atomic bomb, you have some idea of what was happening in that restaurant and afterward. There was the cold shoulder. There was the pout. There was the, how dare you? And all I knew was to keep my mouth shut and try to survive this because it was killing me. And all this toxic spillover from the atomic bomb, the nuclear waste, all those words that she said, and then I said as well, because I was angry. I was angry at trying to continue to please someone that I couldn't please. And no one seemed to care about how I felt. I was just here to make her family happy and to make her happy. That was it. Well, there was a lot of tension, you can imagine, until she left. But the day she left, I felt great relief. I also felt tremendous guilt, tremendous shame. It's just condemnation rained down on me. Her mother, how dare you? She will never be able to trust a man again. You have ruined her life. She will never be able to trust God again. Oh, see how we weave God into these things too. And all that condemnation raining down on me. I had made a series of very serious mistakes. I had some help from people I had trusted, but nonetheless, I had made some very serious mistakes. Well, 10 days after Susie left, I was eating Mexican food. Had my first chicken burrito, and so like a sitcom, this little story has a happy ending, but not so fast. That's the kind of relationship that we have all made mistakes in, with the best of intentions. I had the best of intentions for this. I wanted to do everything by the book, honorable for her parents, to have a great marriage, to have, so that everyone got what they wanted. I made a mess. Nobody got what they wanted. Although I did gain some wisdom. There are some things that I learned. A few months later, I got a call from a counselor in the Seattle area who asked if I wanted to come for a reconciliation meeting with Susie. Well, because of all this tension, all this anger, I didn't want to leave all these feelings on the table. If someone could help us with this, I said, sure, I'll come. I was a bit skeptical, but it was a husband and wife team that did these reconciliation meetings. What they said is, Susie, we want you to tell David how he's hurt you. And then, David, you'll have a chance to tell Susie. We want you to listen to each other. And then we'll allow you to ask for forgiveness. And we're going to go back and forth. I said, okay. So Susie started. She says, well, when I came to San Diego, I thought I was coming for someone who loved me. I said, well, wait a minute. You were pushing me. You were coercing me. We said, stop. They said, stop, stop. That's exactly why relationships get nowhere. Both of you are talking. Nobody's listening. You've both hurt each other. You both need to own it. You've both made mistakes. David, I want you to listen to her, and I want you to tell her what she's saying. I want you to repeat back to her what she's saying. I want you to do it. Tell her you understand how she felt. It doesn't matter whether you meant it or not, how she felt. Ooh, I had to listen. I had to listen to, that's hard. You know, I had no model for that in my family. Maybe you did in yours. I think most of us probably didn't have a model for listening to someone tell you how you have hurt them. It takes actually a pretty big person to do that. It takes a person who knows their identity to do that. And before that meeting, I did not have that skill, but I learned it in that meeting. I said, Susie, what you're saying is you believe that I loved you, and that's why I asked you to marry me, and you were expecting a man who loved you to be meeting you in San Diego, and I deceived you. He turned to Susie. Susie, do you think that David understands? She said, yes, I think he understands. David, you can ask Susie to forgive you now. Susie, would you forgive me for deceiving you into believing that I loved you and I did not? Okay, David, it's your turn. Well, every time I tried to tell her that I was uncomfortable, that wasn't right for me, she started to cry and basically make me move forward if I was a real Christian man. And she said, well, I didn't mean to. He said, it doesn't matter what you meant. Nobody gets into a relationship meaning to hurt the other person, hoping you make a big mess. With the best of intentions, we make big messes. Big messes. Christian people make maybe even bigger messes than non-Christian people, because God is somewhere in there and we believe he has brought this couple together that now has all this pressure, including God and the prophecies and people's dreams and whatever else. The best of intentions, we make very big messes. Susie, we want you to repeat back to David. And so she said, when he tried to explain that he didn't have feelings for me, I couldn't hear that. and made him move forward. And she asked for forgiveness, and I forgave her. And we went on like that for an hour. And I grew in that hour. I had no idea that you actually could repair a relationship, that you could give forgiveness, that you could say, I'm so sorry that I hurt you. You could acknowledge the hurt without diminishing yourself. Somehow in my mind before that, I believed if you acknowledged that you had done anything wrong, maybe this is part of my profession as well, you acknowledge that you've done anything wrong, well, now you're open, you're vulnerable, and you're going to be in trouble. You will be sorry that you ever said, yes, I'm guilty of that. I learned that we need to be authentic. We need to be honest. Now, Susie wanted us to get back together. I just couldn't do it. I had been eating Mexican food for a couple of months, and it was the distance, whatever it was, it just wasn't right for me. And so I chose not to get back together. And some years later, Susie married. I was very happy to hear that, very relieved to hear that, since her mother said she would, you know, forever be single because of me. And then a few years after that, I met Naomi and we married. And I can tell you that after 6 months, the feelings don't go away. Even after, I could even say after 6 years, it is a vibrant marriage if you have someone who listens, who you can listen to, and who you can have that kind of give and take, that kind of beautiful relationship. I want to do a couple of exercises with you tonight. The first one is I want you to think about this story. What would have happened had the medicine I was taking worked? I want to give you a moment to think about that. We are so sold on medicines and relief from our pain. God was trying to give me a message. My body was trying to give me a message. There was something here. As I said to you, I believe that relationship problems are the number one cause of illness. They will depress your immune system, and you will pick up who knows what. The cancer cells will keep growing. If there is a relationship in your life, taking medicine is not the way to fix that toxic relationship. Is there some way that the medicines you're taking, the things that you're doing, the places you're looking for a fix, may not be what God intended the way your body to respond? My body was responding to danger. The GI system is very sensitive to danger, very sensitive to stress. And even though I was unwilling to see it, or I couldn't even see it, not even when the doctor asked me if I was under stress, the Holy Spirit will show you. Now here I was, this neurosurgeon, totally out of touch with my own heart. I was a machine and expected relationships to work like machinery. Behavioral modifications. Oh, I'll do that trick and hold it like this. Oh, it's interesting. Yeah, the old fragile egg, right? This is just an analogy. It's just like the old ball and chain, right? It's that one takes place in the prison, one's sort of a poultry example, but it's the same thing. This was not godly counsel. This was something probably he had received. And come to think of it, I don't think that he spent much time with his daughter, and that's why she was so hungry to trap me and coerce me into this relationship that was not right for me or for her, willing to have a man marry her even if he didn't love her. That's an unfathered woman. So how do this famous author, I guess I also learned that famous people, you know, not all of them have great families. We have King David as an example. They write good books, but perhaps you have to look at the fruit before you say, oh, I'm going to buy that. I want into that family. So I just want to pause for a moment. I want you to think about the places that you seek comfort or relief of your pain. And talk to God about that. Is it we are so dependent on the medical system now that I wonder if we should ask God if there's another way. I'm just going to give you a moment of silence right now. One of the things that I learned was that I am a people pleaser. People pleasers are very susceptible, very vulnerable to codependency, to someone coming along saying, oh, let me help you with your relationships. Let me help you with your life. You need my help. So you can't do life on your own. You need my help. A caretaker. A burden bearer, I would say a false burden bearer. I was, with her help and her father's help, taking responsibility for someone's emotions that were not my responsibility. And I felt that that was a burden that God wanted me to bear, and it was not. I wonder if there's someone in your life with whom you have a difficult relationship. You can't seem to get free. When they text you, something happens inside of you. It's like, if you think about it, it's your body saying there's danger here. It takes you probably 5 or 10 minutes to craft that text back. It's like a legal document. You're like, oh, I don't want to go, but I don't want to offend them. You don't have freedom. As people of faith, people of God, Christians, we are supposed to be caring for everyone, loving everyone. I question that now. Not every problem has my name on it. Not every problem has your name on it. I want to pause now, and I want you to ask. We all have these people. If God has said, this is your problem, I want you to be the caretaker for this person. No matter what they say, no matter what they do, you stand by them. Well, that's a direct order from God. And the Holy Spirit is telling you to do something, and He will empower you and your body to stand up under what you're going to face or what you're facing. But most of us are doing this because we are afraid of the consequences of saying no to that person, what they're going to think of us. These are people who talk a lot. There are people who are in famous families. These are people who are going to try to use whatever leverage they have to control you, and you're afraid of them. It might be a family member. It might be a colleague at work. This is what makes work stress so difficult. It's not the job. We all have stress. Your body is designed to handle stress. It is not designed to handle constantly toxic relationships. That will make you sick. That will depress your immune system, and whatever disease you have, whatever illness you have, is going to get worse. And part of the cure, unfortunately, it's going to get worse before it gets better. You're going to have to do the hard work of setting boundaries. of being courageous. You need a support system. You need God's help. You need to be convinced that God wants you free, right? It's for freedom that Christ died. He has set us free. He doesn't want us in bondage, trying to please someone or at least not make them angry. Many of us grew up in families where we had to walk on eggshells and tiptoe. There was one dominant person who we had to please all the time. We couldn't make them angry. And so we learned. People pleasers learned, oh, I can do that dance. And what I've seen is it works up until about age 40, 35, 40, and your body then no longer will deal with you pretending. Somehow before 30, 35, you can go to sleep and wake up, you can be in whatever you want, you can get in and out of relationships. Somehow your body no longer tolerates that, saying, I want you to be authentic. You are pretending. And that's not going to be healthy for you. I want to pause. Those who are people pleasers, you need to do some work with God now. You need to say, this relationship, I recognize when that text or that email comes in, when that call comes in, when that person says they're coming over, I cringe. But I'm so afraid of them. I've never admitted it, but I'm afraid of their anger. I'm afraid of what they'll do and what they'll think and what they'll say. And I admit that I'm not free, but I want to be free. God, would you help me get free? Because I'm pretending. I'm living a lie. But I sense danger there. Are you big enough, God, to protect me? Because I haven't had the faith to trust you with this dangerous relationship. So I'm going to give you a minute of silence right now. Okay, I want to take another minute to think about this aspect. Those of us, and I believe all of us, in some relationships, do what Susie was doing to me. We use manipulation, we use coercion, we use threats, we use our words, sometimes we use the Bible. Because we're so afraid that that person is going to make a mistake. And if that person makes a poor choice, it's going to hurt us. Often this happens in families, that we have to control the brother or sister or mother or child. That we've got to make sure that they don't make this mistake, because if they do, we know, you know, we're going to suffer too. And it's going to be a mess, and we're going to probably have to bail them out. So we have been using anger, pouts, violence, silent treatment, cold shoulder, sarcasm, rolling the eyes. Do you know sarcasm? Oh, great. Oh, here you did it again? Huh. Oh, that'll be great. I'm sure that'll work out just fine. You know, that's what we think of as comedy now. We think of sarcasm as really comedy. You know, the word sarcasm, sarc, flesh, chasm, tearing, flesh, tearing. It is the number one predictor of divorce. Sarcasm. we think it's, oh, it's just funny. It's just a joke. What is just a joke? It's not a joke. Someone's using sarcasm with you. It's a contemptuous form of speech. Do you participate in that kind of control? Because if you do, your heart is at risk. The people who have heart disease, strokes, it is more common in people who have this kind of anger and control. So I'm going to give you a moment. We all tend to do it. It comes out of our fear that we try to get people to do what we want them to do. Maybe you're pushing a little too hard. It's not your job to control people. That's God's job. They have a good father. It's not you. They have a savior. It's not you. You have to even give up this desire to escape pain and suffering to keep them from making mistakes. I'm going to give you a minute now. If you're guilty of any of that, this is a good time to confess, a good time to repent. This is stuff that we all do. We do it even in our little relationships with neighbors. We try to get people to do what we want. Is it time to just, I mean, I even have people saying, oh, we never see you anymore. You never come to visit us. Just a little bit of guilt there. You know, you can say the same thing, but in a different way. Hey, David, we'd love to see you. Anytime you want to come by, you're welcome here. So good to see you. Same thing. No guilt. But we all tend to use it because it's worked for us in the past. Are you pushing people to do things that it's not good for you? It's a position, again, a responsibility you've taken that is not yours, and it's draining energy from you, and that will make you sick. So let's repent and confess some of that. Last thing I want to do is something I'll call identificational repentance. It's the process that I went through with Susie. Most of us, I'm going to say all of us, have a relationship in the past where we've made mistakes, where other people have made mistakes, where they've hurt you, and you have trouble to forgive them. It's hard to forgive people. Because you really cared about them and they somehow took your fragile egg and they dropped it. Your heart, and they dropped it. And what I want to do is say, I'm going to ask you on behalf of that person, that man or that woman, I'm going to ask your forgiveness for those of us who are emotionally immature. We didn't know. We didn't have the skills to handle this relationship. I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I hurt you. I didn't have the skills, the time, the tools. I didn't have the background. I never saw it in my family. I'm a wounded man, and I didn't treat you with the respect that you deserved. I'm wounded, you were wounded, our wounds came together and we made a mess. I'm sorry. Can you forgive me? Can you see that I didn't intend this, but I needed to get out. I couldn't live this way for whatever reason, and I need your forgiveness. I want to ask you to just say, yeah, I forgive you. And maybe you can say, you know, I wasn't so mature either at that time. I made some mistakes too. Would you forgive me? Yeah, I'll forgive you. And I want to step in there for those fathers who have given really poor advice to their children, or their example, or their fragile egg, or whatever advice you've had from a mentor or a father, someone you've looked up to, and they've really let you down. They gave you terrible advice. They led you down the wrong path. I want you to say, I'm sorry, that's the best I could do. That's what I did, and I want you to forgive me. Let's forgive those people who have given us poor counsel and led us astray. Led us into situations that made a real mess. Lastly, I want to ask forgiveness on behalf of the medical community. Many of you have been injured by the medical community. Emotionally injured, physically injured, they've done something to you. They've done a surgery on you or someone that you love. And when it didn't go so well or they still had pain, you couldn't get them on the phone. They didn't want to see you anymore. Or you felt that they were in a hurry, or they didn't have time for you. They treated you with disrespect. I want to apologize on behalf of the medical community. And if you're holding on to any bitterness or resentment from the medical community, would you forgive me? Could you let it go? Can you understand? We are human, and we make mistakes. And when we do, it's very hard to face them. We are very fragile inside. And if that comes off as arrogant or cold, it's because we are emotionally immature, and I'm sorry. Can you forgive and give God a chance to make it up to you, what you need for that healing, for that relationship, for that father? Let God step in and do those things for you. I'm just going to give you a moment of silence. Father, I thank you. I thank you for everyone who's come tonight. I thank you for these wounds. I thank you for that you have created relationships really to humble us and to make us realize we all make mistakes, and we can be humble and fix them, and we can come to you as our example of how to forgive. Lord, I pray for healing, for everyone who needs healing, physically, emotionally, spiritually. Everyone who needs fathering would receive that from you, even if we didn't receive it from our own fathers. I pray a blessing on everyone here and everyone listening to me in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, thank you.
Lord, we do thank you for this word of liberation. This word of hope, this promise that you have brought to us, that if we would humble ourselves and let ourselves be vulnerable before you, there'd be a chance to begin again. Lord, we do ask that as we are here in this room, even now, the work that you have begun, you would continue, that you would speak to us even now about the need that you triggered through David's words, and that you would give us the courage to begin perhaps for the first time, or to pick up again something that we thought we had taken care of a long time ago and discovered, oh, there is more work to be done. We thank you that you are a good Father and that we can trust you. Lead us, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for this word and for this gift, and we ask that you bless David and Naomi as they continue to share your word with others. Go with them, Lord, and bless them on their way. We praise you, Lord, for what they have done in our midst. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to ask my prayer team to come forward. David said, this may be hard for folks because whenever I give my testimony, it's going to be a trigger. And I can see that. Come forward, prayer team. And some of you may be triggered, so you may have to pray first, and that's okay too. These will pray with you. We're going to put music on in a little bit. Even as we were praying ahead of time, one of the prayers was for those who feel like no one sees them. So, in a sense, I heard that as a word, that there's somebody here who their whole life hasn't felt seen or appreciated for who they really are. And if that's you, then come on. As he was speaking, it reminded me of the first time I went to the healing rooms here, and I got the image shared of a little boy in a corner by himself. And then the rest of the message was that the Lord came around the corner and met me. And the funny thing was, I had that vision and thought it was for someone else, but it was me. So I know this feeling of being unseen and not cared for. We talk about fathers. He brought that up, but it could be mothers. It could be a previous relationship. It could be something that's still unresolved. Out of the team here, did any of you hear a word that you want to release, that you want to invite people to come pray? So, as we've just heard, pain in the body can often have this emotional origin. So, Derry got the word about somebody with a pain in the left arm, elbow. If that's you, she's ready to pray. Mel, you got one? Yes, Lord. So we surrender in order to receive you, Lord. Help us to release that which we've held on to that holds us in bondage. Lead us, Lord. Anyone else? So we'll put music on. We'll pray for you. Those of you online, text or send a post. Because of our camera situation, I can't see your prayer requests right now. But Lord, we just ask that you continue to do this work that you have for us. Forgive us for thinking that we could make this happen on our own. We come and depend on you. In Jesus' name. I'm going to sign off online and put the music on so the rest of us can pray. Thank you for joining us. We will pray for you. Send us a text or an email or a post. Thanks for being with us. God bless you.